Morning, everyone. Today we're just going to go back from the beginning and talk about certain aspects of the case. So people who have joined the group and are not aware of stuff will understand the situation. So from 1981 up to the current day, we're going to talk about certain aspects of the case. Oh, now I'm going to turn it over to my wifey. She has some interesting things to say about the case.
I have lots of interesting things to say about the case. I've got to say, I used to follow your story for quite a long time, and I never fully understood how you got convicted, why you confessed, and the whole thing that surrounded it. But when we sat and read the undisclosed evidence, I think not only was I shocked, I think you were quite shocked as well, don't you think?
Yeah, quite true, because there was stuff in there I'd never seen before, and we found some interesting stuff as to why we were actually targeted.
Yeah, I mean, at the beginning, I thought you'd solely push someone else under the bus and got you both convicted, but reading the things that we read, the other statements, everything that happened before you even got arrested, your name was in the frame before this crime actually happened. The police were just sat waiting for a robbery or such like, and your name was top of the list, nothing to do with you, and none of that were true, which that really did shock me.
It did surprise me, because I wasn't even aware of it.
Well, a lot's been made about how you were arrested and that you got arrested and went to police station and went, me and so-and-so did this murder. When, to people who just read the headlines over the years, probably think that's true. But we both know that that is not true. You were walking that Monday, not really sure why it matters to some how many people were there who arrested you or where you were going. Another story shows that you were going to have your hair cut, which is totally untrue, and you know where you were going and it wasn't there. You didn't even have any money for a haircut. But, I mean, that's by the by. It's incidental trying to sway people off what actually happened. You had no idea. You knew about the murder, but you had no idea you'd be arrested. After the original suspects were released, they were arrested on the Friday afternoon, because obviously the police went straight to where the threats were made. And then they were released by Saturday, and then you were in the frame.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't until we read that little piece about the jobs given 4 months earlier, four months-ish earlier, that your name had been put in frames for these fictitious jobs. You're going to be armed, and betting shops, bingo halls were going to get robbed just because someone else had been arrested. Not quite sure why they offered this up, because they actually put themselves in the frame as well. But people need to believe this part of it, and this is where the story really started, long before this murder ever took place.
And then you'd have to ask the question as to why was it hidden for over 20 years, along with the original suspects' evidence?
Well, this has happened in many miscarriage of justice cases. And when there's been so many mistakes, like yours, Kevin Lane's, Luke Mitchell's, you've got to think, who wants this to come out? They want it to stay well and truly buried. What I won't understand is the haste that they released the original suspects. I mean, granted, they'd be pretty stupid to threaten to kill him and then the next day actually do it, but was it a double bluff? Did people who know that he got threatened use this to their advantage to do this robbery, knowing that the fingers were going to point straight to the original suspects?
Yeah, and then there's a point about where the other people involved, because it's so strange that one person turned up at the betting shop, did as usual, shouted through the letterbox, seen the gate open across the jar, across the pavement, seen the lights on and shouted through and didn't raise no alarm. He went away, spoke to someone else, got the papers that had not been picked up, given to him by the news agents, and then he waited for another colleague from the betting shop, who was a paid colleague, to come up before he went back with them and then raised the alarm. So it makes you think, did this person know something was going on?
Well, the victim got there half an hour earlier than he normally would. His routine were pretty steadfast. He'd go get the papers and the milk. He used to arrive about 20 to 10. On this morning, by 20 to 10, he were dead. You've got to think how many people knew he was actually going to go that early. The light was on, but no witnesses said that the victim went into the shop, put the light on, then went to the paper shop by 9:15. Did he do that, or was somebody already laying in wait? Did someone have keys to let themselves in? Someone official who would go unnoticed? Or is there another reason why the light was on? Because Mr. Suffield was not in the shop when the light was on, but we still don't know who turned it on.
No, but just say, for instance, that the light was on and he was already being fucking killed.
No, he can't have been killed because he'd collected his papers at 9:15.
Mm-hmm.
And he was seen at 9:35, mm-hmm. let himself in, and by 9:45, we know for sure that he was dead.
Mm.
And when the newsagent went to knock to give him the other papers, there were no sign of life whatsoever. So the perpetrators had been gone, the murder mm-hmm. took place.
Yeah, and it's interesting that on such an absolutely busy junction, you've got Upper Palmer Street, Lodge Lane, Tunnel Road, Smithdown Road and Ale Road, which is all roads off with such busy traffic.
But the thing is,
that nobody's seen nothing.
If someone had keys and just let themselves in normally, be it the victim, someone who worked there, the bar marker shouting through like he normally did, there wouldn't be much to notice. There were,
No one
would see anything out of the ordinary. It'd just be the shop opening, someone walking by. That fact remains, we don't know how they got in or who got in.
No, so that raises the question, is how many people had access with keys? Now, we know a person went in and tidied up, which was, I don't know if it was normal. They had keys, so did they keep the keys? Did they give the keys to someone else? Because it's so strange that people seeing three young girls going in and out of the back. Now, we don't know if it was a back in the betting shop with keys. Now, the keys have never been found.
But yet the whole building was locked up.
Yes. So how did people...
It would take time to even do that.
Yes. So how did they get in and how did they get out without being seen? Which is an interesting point. Because one witness's evidence was exchanged for someone else's at the appeal court.
Well, that's what we've got to look back. David Jessel did a documentary. He went round the streets with photo fits of an innocent man who's nothing to do with it. Raymond, who's also an innocent man, and the other person involved in this case. And they were determined to morph the photographs into who they wanted to be. And it was all untrue. Everything that he said, the scuffle that he witnessed, the whole facts about this documentary are untrue. They didn't see three people having a scuffle. They didn't see mixed race men. We don't even know if they saw men. It could have been women. We don't know who did it. But in that documentary, David Jessel was determined to say that everything looked like Ray and the unnamed man. But at the appeal, this whole scenario was ruled out. Everything changed. Mr. Suffield let himself in as normal, just a bit later, just past 9:30. Let himself in. And that's that. That's all that's known about this case. Everything that was claimed, the photo fits. Now, you've got to think, this lady who gave the statement, and first she just saw messing about. Then she was sat with the police, and miraculously, she drew or help to create photo fits that could resemble the two people who went to prison for this crime, but they actually don't. And at appeal, all this was dismissed. Mr. Suffield opened the shop as normal, went in. So these photo fits are null and void, and yet they're still hanging around and people can still point the finger going, oh, that's him and that's him. But she just saw someone mucking about till she sat with the police. Now, did they create these photo fits, taking into consideration that they had names of two people who were going to do these betting shops, bingo hall robberies? were all fake and all lies, and we've got the documentation to prove it, but they wanted the photo fits to look like A and B, and so that's what they created. These photo fits, nothing to do with whoever killed Mr. Suffield. If we believe what happened at appeal, and we've got to, these people don't even exist.
Well, the appeal, I mean, is interesting, as you say. The exchange, one witness who said she's seen two people struggling and a third person leaning against the lamppost. She said she walked past them both, looked back, didn't really get a proper view, but then was able to draw photos of them both. But then another person come forward after over 20 odd years and say she went past that at a different time and seen them outside and actually spoke to them. So with that being exchanged, it's a different time for what actually for this crime that happened. Also, the appeal court rubbished the confession, said it wasn't worth the paper it's written on. Also rubbished the evidence from inmates to say they were a bunch of liars. So if it was good enough to substantiate an appeal for the other person, when the appeal court are saying the evidence is not worth a fucking toss, it should have cleared us both.
Yeah, let's think about what's in your false confession, which causes a lot of furore, despite other people's cases and the most well-known cases all having false confessions. You did 7. Your statement when you confessed, if it was solid and correct, firstly, you wouldn't have needed or been encouraged to make these other false confessions. But the more the police learn, the more your story changed. And it's been proven at appeal that everything you said never happened. So where were you getting your details from to make the story that you were telling fit the police's story that's been blown apart at appeal? It clearly, you didn't do what you said you did or what the police told you said to say you did, because that never happened. That the appeal for the other party has proven that that never took place. You've documented as buying A, B and C with the money. They never found any money on you. You never had any money. There were no new tables, new tellies, nothing. No one saw you spend 50p or £50. There's no new furniture. That was all part of the process of you giving the police what they wanted to hear. Now, if you had have had a new telly, it still didn't prove that you robbed the money, but at least it had proved that you had the ability to buy it. Nothing. Everything in the flat was as it was before. Your alibi when you were first interviewed, your story matched word for word. She told the truth, you told the truth. But then, as time went on and you were left without a solicitor and you panicked and were coerced and everything else that came along with that false statement, you put her in a position where she'd been remanded. She had to change her story to get out. You'd already confessed. Now, we've got to remember this were a young girl at 18. Panicking, in trouble with the police probably for the first time. So she had to save herself, and no one can blame her for that. Not one person can blame. But at the get-go, you said you didn't do it, and so did she. Now, other things came into play and obviously changed that. No one's pointing any fingers to what happened after that. But like with all the hidden evidence, people have got to remember, if you say one thing and the police want you to change your mind, so to get out of being remanded, you change your story again. All these years later, who's to say she's frightened to say the police did A, B and C? And she's stuck in the dilemma that you've been stuck in for the last 43 years.
Yeah, that's exactly, because, I mean, stuff has gone on and continues to go on to impede my battle for justice. But what is also interesting, talking about, I mean, other aspects. Now, we, from reading the undisclosed, which there was 201 witness statements not given to the defence at trial, which tells a completely different story and points at other people. Now, what is interesting is there was two people seen running away at the top of Smithdown Road on the waste ground by two brothers who were working on the church roof at the time, which could overlook Lodge Lane and the surrounding areas. They were never traced. Two people were seen running down the side of the bingo wall in Beaumont Street, nearly knocked a woman over on the way down on the right-hand side, ran into a block of masonettes, which were right down on the right-hand side from the back of the bingo wall to the Clock public house. There was rows of masonettes. They come out with a change of clothing each. A young child tried to come with them. They told the child to get away. They had to get away. Now, why did they have to get away? What had they done? These were never traced. Several people in a brown car were seen screeching out of Lawton Street, which was behind the betting shop. Now, they nearly crashed into another car. They turned down onto Beaumont Street, went across the junction between Kingsley Road and Selborne Street, then turned on the corner of Mulgrave Street, across Parliament Street, onto Dove Street, and disappeared into the Faulkner housing estate. Now, we don't know whether these people were involved. It's just like things like that, which was contained in the undisclosed, questions should have been asked. And also, which was suspicious, I mean, we don't know how much money they exactly robbed, because there was money, we believe, money bags lying on the floor. One person was spending money in a pub, in the Coach and Horses, went to the bar, asked for £4 of 50 pence pieces to be exchanged for notes. He said he'd won this money on the slot machine. He then went back a second time and asked again and tried to say he'd won it again. He was watched all night, never went near the machines. And a barmaid raised the issue with another barmaid. They were talking about the crime. This man overheard them and hastily left the pub before he could be asked any questions.
To put that in context, though, Ray, I remember when I first went out drinking in 1986, I could get 3 halves of lager for £1.50. So where people are hearing this and thinking, oh, 50p, everyone's got 50p, you've got to put it in context of what the money was worth at the time. Plus, at the scene, the money wasn't dropped and spread all over the floor. It's neatly placed, and there's bloody footprints walking over it, at least 2 different sets of footprints on the bags. Now, why, with the whole space that's there, firstly, would you not take the money? Would you leave it so perfect? It's not scattered. And why would you find a need to keep standing on it? We don't know if that's to prove a point or anything. But what we do know about the other arrest and investigations, that the alibis of the original suspects, now we're not pointing the fingers to them either, because we have got no idea, but they made no sense. They didn't add up. Now, if we can work out their journeys and see there's a huge discrepancy, and there is a gap between 9:05, 9:10, and 10:00, where no one's accounted for, the journeys don't make sense, it doesn't add up. Why would they need to lie? Why did not raise suspicions with the police? You know, they should have worked out the movements, the steps, how long it would take to do what they did. And they don't seem to have looked into that whatsoever. Plus, thanks to the documentary that David Jessel did, okay, some parts are a bit harrowing and full of lies, as I've mentioned, but there's a lot of good points to that. That's why we've recorded it and saved it all. The original suspect, just a couple of days before you, describes his treatment in the police station. And what did he say? Very much word for word, what you were saying.
Exactly.
So that's another mixed-race man being arrested.
Being pressurised.
abused, shouted at, coerced. After 2 days, he didn't know whether he'd committed the crime or not, and we've got his own words saying that. So the treatment Ray described, which has been discredited or tried to be discredited by others, saying that there's no proof of that. I mean, I'm not sure how you get proof of mistreatment in a police station. Do we think that they're going to get the notebooks out and jot it all down and go, I abused him, I stamped about, I grabbed hold of him, I were putting photos on the table telling him who did it. Now, I've got to remember, when they was putting the photos on the table, they were telling you who did the murder. Before you told them, you didn't go get arrested and go, oh, we did it. They were kept telling you over and over again, and no one in the right mind would think that that would be documented.
No, back in 1981, we had it confirmed by the head of the chief constable's coloured police officers' federation that the police were targeting the coloured community in 1981. Now, you're talking, this crime happened prior to the toxic riots in 1981, but at the time, we've got community activists on the actual programme admitting that if they were stopping coloured people in the Liverpool 8 area, if you acted in a certain way, they would take you somewhere, beat you up, fit you up on charges, just if you'd acted in the wrong way. So it does substantiate what I've said. On my third interview in Admiral Street Police Station, they took me into a holding room next door to the charge desk, and on the table were 2 photo fits. And as soon as I walked in, the 2 police were banging on the fucking table, going, nothing else, it's you, that's you, that's your mate. From information we've received, you're the heavy, he's the bag man. Now, I don't know what information, if they did get any, they'd receive. But what's strange is the original suspects was a gang who were known as the Hatchet Gang, and had previous for robbing betting shops. So if that had come to light, why weren't their whole stories checked out proper? Because they weren't.
Outright as well, on the documentary, the other party involved in this case, his own brother said that's how they behaved.
Yeah.
And you just get arrested and mistreated for nothing whatsoever. So it's coming from 3 different independent parties to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Back up exactly how the police treated people in 1981.
And also, what we might have, but we haven't had it confirmed, is vulnerability. Now, both people involved had low IQs and probably should have had adults with them for the questioning in the station, which was never being looked at in this case. I mean, certain circumstances I've come to light, which we can't really say at the minute because we've got 2 experts involved in the case who were looking at certain stuff. We have got a preliminary report, which one of the experts thinks the robbery was actually staged to hide something else. Now, until we get a full report, people would just say, well, it's just conjecture at this minute in time. But it's interesting the way the bags were supposed to be scattered on the floor, footprints all over him, the way he was tied up with a knot, which some people reckon people who were sailors would probably know the type of knot he was actually tied up there with. And it's stuff like that, besides other stuff, because we've had to go to St. George's Hall and have a look at the cells back in the day. Now, it confirmed what I've always said about being next door to each other in certain cells, them sitting outside on a table, going up to court in a lift, coming out and talking, where certain things were actually said, you could communicate through the vents.
Yeah, well, we've got a statement to that effect as well, haven't we? Not only could you communicate, people did, and quite often, pass tobacco through the same vents that shows easy access for things as well as conversations to be had, which just reinforces your story that you've said all along, what were told to you at trial and why you had to change your plea. And this has been proven, and it will be put forward with other documents when we need to.
Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, years ago...
Also, I've got plans on the whole thing, charges are.
Yes.
I've got the internal workings and everything, so if anyone wants to have a look at them, they're kind of interesting for a little bit. But mm-hmm. We've got all them safe and secure as well, because we don't leave any stone unturned, so why not have the plans as well?
Mm-hmm. Plus the CCRC... We're aware of CCRC. I've said they're going to look at 5,000 closed cases. But what's important about the CCRC, for years, they requested to conduct DNA testing. They had 6 slides they found and were humming and ahhing. They have never been tested. We don't know.
Well.
Yeah, and then there's supposed to be fingerprints on an envelope, which have never been revealed as to whose it was. Now, we do understand as well that for some reason, somebody has been passing information from the CCRC to a third party to interfere with investigations into my claims of innocence. Several applications have actually gone in, and someone's being told by the CCRC exactly what is contained in my applications, which shouldn't be happening under the Data Protection Act. Now, they've lied to say that they haven't, but a source has gone live on a podcast to say he gets told and he'll find out anyway. So we don't understand why this is going on, you know what I mean?
But if we're talking dirty tricks and everything,
yeah,
people have been out there, well, a couple of people, most people can see beyond what's been said, well, quite a lot of people can anyway, and that we've got their feedback and support, stamping the feet and carrying on saying, I've got the evidence. No, what they've got is false confessions, like happened in their case. They've got you saying whatever you said, what the police told you to say, what you were coerced into saying, what you were threatened into saying. That's not evidence. That's you sat there doing what you were told, fearing for your life, and all the rest that went with it. Words on a piece of paper, not evidence. If they've got evidence, which they've been asked to provide, but they always kind of leave it going, oh, we'll be back to this at a later date. Oh, well, but then it never comes. They're always going to. There is no evidence. There's no witnesses, no DNA, no clothing, no items bought, no items discovered. The alibi said word for word that they were with you. You had no need to be there. It was half an hour away from you. You didn't drive. You're not telling me that you went in, you massacred a poor man and got on a bus full with blood. The footprints prove how bloody the scene was. There's no way did that happen. You had an alibi to say where you was. And we're a bit startled to see why people keep saying there's evidence, there's nothing.
There's no evidence. I mean, talking about, and we go back to the DNA. Now, whatever they had at the time was supposed to have been tested. And the category states there's no trace of any fibre or anything from me or the other party to link us to this crime.
And the man, by the looks of the crime scene photographs, they were thrown about, manhandled, put on the floor, tied up. There'd have been a lot of connection with whoever did it. And there's nothing to point to the people who were jailed for this. So that means murderers are still walking the streets, and there's never been any justice for the victim or his family, because this is not justice at all. And people trying to derail this in the name of justice need to really have a word with themselves, because someone got away with a brutal murder. A man was stabbed 19 times. Now, that's personal. If you want to rob the money from a betting shop, firstly, you'd have taken all the money from the betting shop. If you're au fait with the safe and how money is, and obviously 50p's, there were some notes on the floor, but you're going to at least expect to take this money away. And if you use this amount of violence, why did you leave quite a large pile of coins on the floor? You kept standing on them. They wasn't dropped and scattered, they were placed. Now, you don't stab someone 19 times to rob and then not leave with everything that you need. Not a murder for money. What was it? Because Michelle Vazelle wouldn't do what they did. And even to tie him up, to see the crime scene pictures, where the rope, cord, whatever, goes behind his back. They didn't need to do that. Possibly we're already dead when that happened, with the things that we found out looking into this case. But we've got to think, on this morning, the man was going to give his keys back. He wanted to quit his job. With the threats that he received the night before, he was overheard a couple of times saying that he wanted to leave. He's told people he wanted to leave. He was supposed to meet the area manager and give his keys back early. So he didn't get a knock on the door and open it and let someone in. He definitely didn't let the ones who threatened him in. So how did they get in? Possibly two knives. There's different footprints, very distinctive footprints. Little circles with a border on a trainer. Now, we're close to sourcing the pattern these trainers made, and there's other footprints to look into. But why the need for such violence? If there were two or three people in there, which there probably was, it could have been overpowered. They didn't need to tie him up. He definitely wasn't tied to a chair, because you can see the photo in the chair, of the chair in the crime scene photos. The size of him, that thing had just tippled over. It wasn't even a working chair. It's just a chair that's in a photograph. It's not part of the crime scene. It's clearly not part of the crime scene. So much violence. Why stab someone in the throat? That's personal. That's not a give us your money, I want what you've got, and I'm going to leave. That there's more to this, that there were so many wounds on this poor man.
Now, what people also don't realise that was this man murdered to protect an illegal betting scam that was going on in that betting shop. Now, remember, the day before, he was threatened by two people who had changed their betting slip and tried to demand winnings. Now, was it a normal practice in the shop that people could change their betting slips before the race was going on or whatever? And other people were involved, and to protect an investigation into the practice, they actually killed them.
Well, the original suspects didn't live too far away, and since we started reading the undisclosed evidence probably 3 years ago now, probably more, we've met up and spoken to him on the phone with quite a few people. Friends, best friends at the time, witnesses. Unbelievably, one lives quite close to us, and startled to what we heard and what we've been told. A lot of it's in text messages. Met them twice, and I've got it there in black and white that this person's mum would not lie. Now, this person's mum, who would not lie, actually stated that she feared for her daughter. It were too serious an event not to tell the truth. She knows that there were more to this story, and it is quite clear that at the time, in her own flat, she was scared to be there. She actually left her flat when the original suspects were talking about this crime, indicating that they were involved and they were worried about a weak link in this case. So she was that scared, she actually left her flat and moved quite a few times around the country and now settled, like I say, not far from us. So she said her mum would like the story about the hatchet gang, the previous, the threats, the conversations on the day, all came from this mum who would not lie. And it's there in black and white that her mum would not lie. So that is confirming that her story was actually true. And what she said at the time, even though the person involved didn't change her statement, she was scared, she was young, but her mum was telling the truth. And we've got all that documented.
Yes, we have. I mean, beside that being documented, the cartoon artist was actually traced. He was spoken to.
Absolutely lovely man.
Lovely man. And he, as I categorically said, he did not draw them photo fits. Well, he didn't draw the actual cartoon drawing that is out there as well.
And I know people have disputed that I had this conversation, but one afternoon, my phone rang, it was a withheld call, and I spoke to this man for an hour. He's not in this, well, he's passed away now, sadly, but he wasn't in this country. He doesn't have email. And it's a long story how I traced him, and probably unbelievable to some. But I found him via his friend, who used to write to him. And all I said to him, please can I speak to him? And I sent my number. And this friend is so amazing. He didn't even ask me why I wanted to speak to him. And there was no question. My phone rang. I sat in my car for an hour speaking to him. And he said this case had bothered him. At that point, it was 42 years. Obviously, another year's passed. For 42 years. He was told what to say at the ID parade. He was told to say what to say regarding his drawing. And he said to me, clear as day, which his friend will be able to confirm, that when he challenged that this drawing was not in his style, the police said, we've got two police officers who saw you draw them. Now, take that whichever way you want. But if he's questioning his style of drawing, and then he was told that two police officers witnessed it, now that's, shut up, you did draw it, we've got people who saw you doing it. Now, he said it's not in his style of drawing, he had a copy of it, he knew what was what, and he denied it. And he knows someone connected to the other person in this case, and he says it's bothered him all this time. Things didn't add up. It didn't add up at all. And he was bamboozled, coerced, and pushed about. He didn't give his free thoughts on this case. He was told and encouraged to say what the police wanted him to say. And that conversation was an hour long because he had so much to say about it. And he said to me, anytime you want to speak to me, just let me know. Now, people can doubt that all they want. I have absolutely no reason to make it up. And if anyone followed the footsteps that I did to find him, it would doable. And someone else could go down the same path and work out how to find him. Obviously, you can't speak to him now because he's passed away. But 100 probable, and I did it. So anyone who doubts it, really, it's nothing to do with you. And I know the conversation that we had. I know when we had it. And I wrote down everything that he said. So that's clear as anything. So that's another person in the case we've talked to.
And then there's the other person which has just came out of the blue, got my phone number, phoned me up and spoke to me for 2 hours on the phone. It would have gone on for more if I hadn't have stopped it. And then we've got messages by text of things that have been said to us about a fair party.
We're just keeping that quiet for now, aren't we? We're
yes.
Going into that.
So we're not actually going in into that. But
we've also spoken to someone else who was a best friend of the crucial witness at the time, and they recall the story as they were told it in 1981, and it just confirms everything we've said, everything the person giving the statement originally said, and that what Ray said is truth, what they said is also true, and they've confirmed that as well. We have spoken and got messages and letters and texts from other people as well, but right now we're not putting their names out or anything, but it's built a solid picture of what didn't happen on 13th of March 1981 and just backs up what Ray was saying.
So as you've heard, we have got two independent experts who we're not going to say who they are. We're just going to say
thank you
to them. They're actually working on the case, and we are going to submit a further application to the CCRC, especially with what's going on with the CCRC at this moment in time.
Say thank you to Sharon for all her support, getting people to join the group and open up discussions, mm-hmm. doing the videos and much, much more behind the scenes. She's working quietly away there like the other two experts, so thank you for that.
And also to other members like me mate in Liverpool, BM, who's a...
Hey up, Billy.
Billy, who's forever there for us, supports us. He's been there as a friend for over 50 odd years since I met him in our secondary school. And he's a cousin as well, who's always supportive.
But all the people who've had you on for podcasts, from Raphael Rowe right back in the beginning, okay, that didn't really work out as well as you expected, but he gave you a voice, he gave you a platform. When he did the documentary, if anyone noticed him listening carefully, he did say two innocent people.
Mm.
So thanks for that, Raphael. Billy Moore, you've met him a couple of times. The last one were a bit mad when we went to Liverpool. Mm. Top man, Billy. And your brother Joe. Ricky Colleen, he was lovely to talk to. Top man, who put you on to Sean Atwood.
Yeah.
And that were an absolute brilliant day meeting Sean.
Yes.
Lovely man. We've both got a signed book, which we're going to keep and treasure. Shame we didn't get to meet your other half and your little baby because they couldn't make it. But thank you for all the help and support and all the comments that your videos have got. And talking about experts, now, this is a bit of a bone of contention, especially for me. Terry Mullins, top expert polygraph tester. Now, anyone can believe that the tests are good, the tests are bad. That's your choice. They are used in cases of sexual offences and also in domestic violence. So somewhere, somebody's got faith in them. But if you don't, that's free will for you to choose and not to. But there's been a lot made about this, and Terry was actually contacted by a miscarriage of justice campaigner, can you believe this, who supports Luke Mitchell, because both him and his mum passed. Well done to Luke and Corrine, especially the situation Luke was in when he passed his test. Corrine must have been in bits to do it, but she still did it. Jeremy Bamber, whether you believe he's innocent or not, he passed the test. Ray passed the test. But you've got to think, not everyone passes the test. Loads of people fail. A murderer were exposed via his polygraph test, and someone sat there and said, here we have the murderer. His story was blown apart, and he had no option but to say, yeah, okay, I did it. And it got justice for the victim's family, finally. Don't know if he thought he could bluff the test or what, I'm not sure. But to actually contact Terry Mullins and say, your test is dud, it's false, your answers are rubbish, and dismiss it while posting on social media and bigging up the test when it's for Luke Mitchell. Now, you can't be selective. You've got to believe that it works or believe that it doesn't. But if you believe that it does, and this person took one themselves, then don't contact Terry Mullins going, nah, your test is rubbish, he's lying. Because Terry's prepared a lovely letter saying any more he will take legal action. Obviously, he didn't give this person time of day and doesn't respect him at all, along with a lot of other people who don't respect him. But to be so malicious and nasty to even try and undermine this test and say it doesn't work, while sharing on Twitter, oh, look, Luke Mitchell's passed a lie detector test now. Where's your head at? Does it work? Doesn't it? You'd either do it or you don't do it. But Ray went down to Kent to do this lie detector. He paid for the train. He paid for the test. Now, whether you believe it or not, Terry would not have stood by him and said, "I believe fully in Ray's innocence," if he didn't pass the test. He wouldn't. He totally stands by Ray. He doesn't like the attempts to blacken Ray's name or his own name. And if any more comments are said, legal action will be taken. We've already got the letter and he's on standby. And I can't actually believe people could be so cheeky, but to deny his test, but then promote it to look good on social media. How weird is that? Someone just out to try and destroy someone else's chance to clear the name. We all should be doing everything we can to support other people. False confessions, lie detectors, it's all part of their arena as much as it is Ray's, Luke's, Jeremy Bamber's. I'm not an expert on Jeremy Bamber's case, but there's a lot of new stuff come out. The amount of undisclosed evidence in his case. Now, that should never have happened. Whatever the outcome is for his CCRC appeal, we can only wish for the best result. But why would anyone need to hide hundreds of thousands of pieces of evidence? Luke's the same. Straight away, they never went down any other line of inquiry. Straight to Luke. Much the same with Ray. Original suspects binned off on Saturday. Ray arrested on Monday. See you later. 36 years he comes out of prison. All these actions have got to be wrong. CCRC let so many people down. The SCCRC are doing the same in Scotland. It's time that things changed. We all should be getting together. We all should be supporting each other. There's lots of intelligent people out there who can and are making a difference, but there's lots of others. Well, not lots of others, there's a few of us who are trying to derail anything and everything. I'm not sure what the motive is, because a successful one is a success for all. It can change the law, change how CCRC works, and it's got to be for the good. I can't stress that enough. If you can help in any way, Kevin Lane, he's got a fundraiser because he's desperate to fight his case to see his little boy. He's been properly stitched up, but then he has right from the beginning. When I first heard about his case by Duncan Campbell, and I've followed it ever since. And that is one man who needs to overturn his conviction, and he's got a CCRC application form going in. We can just wish him all the best and support him as much as we can. If you check out his case, it's absolutely dire that he's been recalled. And hopefully, middle of May might be some good news for him. But let's work together instead of fighting each other. It's just a waste of energy and it's cruel.
Exactly what I would have said. I mean, we're not all in this boat together, because not everyone is a miscarriage of justice. But those who are, we should put your differences to one side and come together and get these cases looked at.
Exactly, not be led by hate,
Yeah.
ego, the need to be, oh, look at me and have your name in headlights. It's not about that. It's about the person who's in prison, and generally, if we're talking about murder, it's about the victim of murder and their family. It's not about you. It's not, well, it is about you in this case, but generally you. It's not about me. It's not about individuals who've cleared the name. Everyone should be working together to get justice for everyone.
Yeah,
You
it's
know?
yeah, exactly. It isn't about, oh, look at me, I'm doing this and that and doing that. It's not about control. It's not about hate, or it's not about personal vindictiveness. It's about people seeking justice.
Anyone who can stab an innocent man 19 times should be in prison and never released. And the people who've done this aren't spent one day in prison for this crime.
No.
Much the same with Kevin Lane's, but his case is a bit different, obviously, with the names that have been put forward. Well, I ain't getting into that. They may be in prison already, but that's not for me to say. And likewise, when you look at Jodie, there's so much fighting, but there's so much intelligence in the infighting, and all you're doing is just destroying whether you think he's guilty or not guilty. You're just destroying everything, and it's just such a waste. It just breaks me out that 20 years on, no one still really knows what happened, and where people are going, they probably never will.
No, we see that much hatred on online trolls. We see videos, podcasts which are criticizing. Now, people want the truth out there. I mean, whoever is in charge of the campaign should come out and start telling the truth, because there's that much in you endos coming out from all different factions about this, that, and that.
Well, the best example of how to behave is Kevin Lane.
Yeah.
All those years in prison, he's always happy, smiling, he helps charities, he raises money, he raises profiles, he always wishes you well, we wish him well, we've donated, I hope more people can donate to help him fight for whatever he needs to do. He's the man that people should aspire to be like. You know, he could be bitter. We listened to him last night, live from prison. And he's just a top man. Someone donated a fiver. He's thanking him and thanking him and thanking him. He don't take anything for granted. Every little bit of support he gets, he welcomes it. He did his 20 odd years. He's been recalled, and he's still smiling. He has no bitterness, no anger to anyone. He just does what he can to help himself and help everyone else. And we need to get behind him and each other. And if you don't like people or you don't agree, don't attack people. Just don't say anything. Go use your time, your brain power, whatever, to do something nice for yourself instead of attacking anyone else. If you don't believe in it, just scroll by it. Don't go out there with nasty motives. Go out there with goodness in your heart. And if you don't want to back someone, don't back people. You don't have to, but you don't have to try and destroy people either.
No, that's true. That some people just want total control, and I think we understand where some people's hate comes from. But to direct that hate onto everything possible when things don't go their way is wrong. But as you see with Kevin and other people, they're humble. They appreciate what people are trying to do on their behalf. And this is what we should all be doing. I mean, around the country, there's that many campaigns going on for various people that we should all be coming together. It doesn't matter if you might not like people or what your opinions are. If that person has spent years in prison fighting their conviction, there has to be something to it. Why would you spend decades inside saying you haven't done it, and you could have got out after 15 years, but continue to fight for your innocence, and not just fight for justice for yourself, but for the victim's
But
family?
even more so, once you're released and you've got your life back, why would you waste your life? Why would you bring attention to yourself? You get your head down and get on with your life. No one would still be saying, like in your case, 43 years. You've been released now for a number of years. You'd be getting on. You'd be having fun. You'd forget all about prison. You know, it has a shocking effect on people. And if you've got no story to change, you won't be talking about it, you won't be part of it. You just won't need to do it. But we've got some exciting things coming up. Got some plans with Sharon, and we're looking forward to doing some more recording very soon. Ray's just nipped for a wee, and I can't get into his phone to do anything else now. So I'll just have to wait for him to return. The boss is back now, so I'll pass it back over to him. And all I can say is thank you, everyone.
Yes, we just want to say thank you to everyone who over the years has been supportive and have helped in this case. We are not going to stop because we want justice for the victim's family and I want justice myself.
But if anyone's got a case out there that needs a shout out, needs any help or advice, we've gone through down some strange and unbelievable paths to get answers for Ray's case, and we would definitely help anyone else who, even if they just want to chat, need any advice on what not to do. We've got a big list of what not to do as well as what to do. So we're always here if anyone needs any help with that. And we'll try our best. We give most cases a shout out, whether it's on Twitter, not so much on Ray's website now, but we are in the middle of doing a new website. And obviously he's got his YouTube channel, his Twitter, he's got his Facebook group, and he's got a wonderful Facebook page that's followed by about 2,500 people, I think, now. That's down to Sharon, so big shout out to Sharon for that, for getting lots of followers. We didn't know if it were a good idea to have a page, but it's turned out to be really good. Obviously, we don't put case updates on there for everyone to see. We do it in our little chat group that's got nice supporters who we know we can trust. Because some things you just have to keep to yourself, because there's been so many chances and times where people have tried to derail us. And a big shout out to my friend Karen, who's helped us with locating people and always there behind the scenes supporting us and doing whatever she can, or just being a listening ear. So thank you, Karen.
And a big shout out to Steph and Ailey, two lovely people who are doing it.
Two amazing people.
People who are doing it, wonderful work on our behalf. We just like to say thank you for your support and help. And if anyone wants to get involved, you can send links to Ray Gilbert is innocent, and we'll answer any questions you have.
But like I've already said, we'll support other cases and be helping any way we can.
So
it's all about helping each other at the end of the day. That's what we've got to do. It's a long nightmare to try and overturn a conviction. So if we can say anything that can help and support someone else, we'll do it, won't we?
Yes, we certainly will. So we wish you all a happy Sunday and look forward to the week ahead. So on that note, we're...
Goodbye, we're off to eat cake now.
Yes, we are. Some more cake.
The lovely farmer's market.
So you take care of yourselves and we'll speak again soon. Goodbye to you all.